So there's this man. He's gone so far down his hole in the ground that now he can't see the mouth back where he came in. But what he does see is a shadow play, cast by people and things way above his head, out of reach and out of sight. He watches the world, or what he thinks is the world, from way below, in shape and silhouette, black and white. But he's about to learn the truth.
Even if you've never read Nick Bostrom's paper on the simulation problem, you'll be aware of it by the shadow it casts.
Oh God, it's a video essay.
As I'm sure you've heard it echoed endlessly online already, the simulation problem goes like this. One day, probably, humanity will develop advanced enough simulations to rival our real world, with thinking inhabitants unaware that they're in a simulation. So how would we know if we were those inhabitants? It goes on to suggest that if more than one simulation of the world were ever built, then the odds that any of us who think that we're alive are actually alive falls to below 50%. We're literally more likely not to exist. Surely then we should vanish in a puff of logic. Nick Bostrom's short paper on the subject was published in 2003, but the problem itself's been around a lot longer. In the ancient days of another century, the Matrix's presentation of this argument was so successful that it became a global phenomenon and cultural touchstone, especially talking about this issue. And before the Matrix, countless other stories, science fiction and otherwise, dealt with this apparently fundamental human feeling of the world not being really real. As long as the human race has been writing, it's been writing about the simulation. All of which is basically to say that what I'm doing here is actually even less original than it looks. This isn't even the first time that this specific TV show has dealt with the problem. Not by a long shot. But today, for the sake of all of you watching at home, at Saturday dinner time, I'm going to try and explore this idea through an episode of Doctor Who called Extremis, the headline twist of which is that the world as we know it isn't real. Spoilers, by the way. Obviously. The story kicks in when the Doctor and friends are summoned by the Pope. You know the guy, Catholic, shits in the woods. After a series of disappearances, to answer an ominous question.
Particle physicists and priests. What could scare them both?
And the answer is, well, everything. All of it. The totality. But we'll work our way up to that. The actual plot of the episode is exceptionally simple. In traditional horror fashion, the characters are picked off one by one. But not by monsters, though there are some, and we'll get to them. But by the knowledge that their lives are not their own, which in itself is enough to destroy them entirely. It's like existential crisis as plague. Again, we're dealing with some pretty heavy subject matter here. So while I endeavour not to be insensitive, please only continue if you are okay with this. The cause of these disappearances is the Veritas. Described as a document, the choice of words already telling, it's not long enough to be a book, more like a pamphlet or a manifesto. And it invites readers to think of a number and find the document has predicted their guess centuries in advance. If the test is performed out loud, any two people trying to conjure a random number will come up with the same one at the same time.
48, 103.
And so it proves that the world isn't real. Like the episode itself, the document doesn't have to be long or complicated because the truth is actually incredibly simple. Here's the first magic trick of the episode. The shadow test doesn't really make sense because computers are bad at random numbers, sure, but they're not that bad. any real simulation wouldn't have such an obvious tell. But that's precisely the primal fear that the episode leads the audience by the hand towards. Any real simulation wouldn't have such an obvious tell. A computer generates its random numbers by taking an arbitrary input, something like the 15th digit of a temperature reading at a very specific time, and running that through a predefined scrambling algorithm. While this wouldn't result in anything like what we see in the episode, it does mean that technically, the random number is deterministic. Anybody who knew the exact temperature, the exact time, and exactly how the algorithm worked could figure out the so-called random number in advance. This is what the episode is keying into. But the problem is, exactly the same thing is true of human beings. Bostrom tried in his paper to prove probabilistically that the simulation is real and that we're inside it. But I think this misses the point of what this fear actually is. It's not black and white with a binary line between real and unreal, between simulation and reality, where all you need to figure out which you're in is a short document. Bostrom's adapting his proof from a much older story, older even than The Matrix, if you'll believe it. An ancient text, a document, or a manifesto, from long ago, which makes the same argument more precisely. That man from the beginning of the video lives in Plato's cave. First proposed in the Socratic dialogue, The Republic, which if you've not read it, is basically the BC equivalent for Ponzi video essay. Plato's cave is an ancient allegory, and it goes like this. If shadows are all you can see, cast in fuzzy black and white on the opposite wall of your cave, how could you comprehend what casts them? Or even that anything was casting them? In other words, how could anyone ever know that their world is the full picture? What we're describing here isn't about computers specifically. It's a phenomenon that's been around a lot longer than the microchip has. And it's just as much about Jim Carrey in The Truman Show realizing when a studio light falls from the sky that his life's being directed by somebody else. Explicitly, according to the author, Extremis 2 is about a TV character realizing that their life is fictional. But we all knew that. We know the Doctor and Friends aren't real because we tuned into the program that this episode of TV is about them becoming aware of. Or, you know, at the very least, we heard the announcer after Country File. And so if we can accept that living in a computer program might feel real to the program people, why not that the same is true of TV programs? There's nothing special, after all, about the language that computers write their stories in. Couldn't the shadow world of metaphor and analogy feel real to the people living in it? Again, quoting the author, books are virtual reality. Extremis says that being unreal is like Super Mario, with all the Goombas and Koopa Troopas and the one that throws tomahawks, realizing that they're being played. And if they're part of a game, and the game's players are part of a simulation, the simulation is part of a recording being watched by the Doctor, who's part of a TV show being watched by the man in the cave, being watched by you at home, surely that just means it's Koopa Troopas all the way down. Shadows casting shadows casting shadows. This video's for you if you know the feeling I'm talking about, and what all these stories are talking about. And I think that's probably quite a lot of you. I see all the time people justifying the insanity of the world we live in, casually talking about the writers getting lazy in the exact same language we use to talk about TV shows like this. So it's not about hard mathematical proof. Bostrom's paper, Plato's cave, Truman's show are all really just about casting a shadow of doubt. We live in the dark. We don't get a definitive answer, we just get a question. Does this feel real to you? All of this? So that's the stage set at the start of our program tonight. I promise you, it's only going to get worse from here. There's going to be gratuitous scene and costume changes, hard turns into oversharing and performative displays of emotion, and meta-humour so far up its own arse that the punchline comes out in a different layer of reality.
So fasten your seatbelts. Unfold the paper bag in front of you if you want to breathe or vomit into it.
Because the premise that there are powers using advanced computer simulations to analyze and control our behaviors isn't actually science fiction.
It's not fiction at all.
What I found a lot of people forget is that there's a second strand to Bostrom's simulation argument. He says that there's no chance of us living in a future simulation if humanity's just not destined to make it that far. There's a phenomenon so common that it has a name. A broken arrow, or in extreme cases, nuke flash incident. The accidental launching, firing, detonating, theft or loss of the weapon. These are events that could easily have led to nuclear war, and thus the end of the world. A warning now that if you're anything like me, this next segment will trigger your dissociation, so be careful. At the height of the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, a curious bear tripped an Air Force base alarm, and a glitch in the system lit up the signal to launch nuclear bombers. Only by doubting the evidence were armed planes stopped on the runway. 2 days later, a US submarine accidentally dropped toy depth charges for training simulations on air-starved, and so presumably already grouchy, Soviets, who were only prevented from nuclear retaliation by one man who could tell that it wasn't real. And then later, literally that same day, a U-2 aircraft...
No, not that one.
That's it. Had its navigation scrambled by a cosmic phenomenon and flew into Soviet airspace. It would have taken just one of the many pilots involved being just a little bit twitchy for everything to go up in smoke. The incident was covered up for decades. And that was just Friday through Sunday, which is insane, because as we all know, the worst possible outcome of a bad weekend in Cuba shouldn't be the end of life on Earth. It should be sunburn, a rum hangover, and some really stupid selfies with a supermarket shelf. Yeah. And these are just a few of dozens of existential horror stories on this topic. And as of today, of those we know about, 6 nuclear weapons have been lost and just never found. So it might occur to you to wonder how we've survived this far, when we apparently come so close, so often, to... And a probabilistic philosopher like Bostrom might point out that in any version of the world where we had dropped the big one, we just wouldn't be here to wonder.
We all go together when we go.
So to go back to the monsters, this is the alien monk's plan across this trilogy. They simulated the whole of human history, let it play out to its inevitable collapse, and then they step in at the last minute as saviors.
How lucky Earth is to have an ally as powerful and as tender.
In another magic trick, born of the three authors' unusual independence, the trilogy's three distinct realities, each artificial in its own way, seems to run on subtly different rules. So, while there is what you might call a certain continuity error between the different set of rules for how the monks use their powers of data and propaganda across these three appearances, their unifying idea, as every monster has one, by the book I'm in, is that any other version of this world, any better one, is not just impossible, but so incomprehensible that it's easier to imagine the end of the world than any alternative, as the saying goes. In The Pyramid at the End of the World, then, the episode following immediately on from Extremis' cliffhanger ending, the monks appear just as powerful in the real world as they did in their simulation. They could take the planet by force, but they say that that would simply be inefficient, because like every leader everywhere, they'd rather have consent. So Bill, our point of view character, is made a surrogate public and coerced by the monk's terrible forecast to vote against her own ideals out of her fear of losing her best friend. In The Power of Nightmares, that's an Adam Curtis documentary rather than a classic Doctor Who story, if the title threw you.
Oh, right, yeah.
The role of power in the 21st century is described as one that doesn't make any promises of actually improving the world, just protecting us from the things that we fear or are told to fear. The monks use their simulations here in the same way, to show humanity our future, and that there is no alternative but to vote for them. But that's the thing about the monks. They're not just accepting consent, they're also informing it by, literally, controlling the narratives that the representatives of Earth in this episode use to make their decisions. They pump a very specific flavour of what looks a lot like news footage directly into their brains. Not for the fear itself, but to create an actual dedication and thankfulness for their intervention. Love, they call it. Or in other words, the monks manufacture consent. In their next story, they start literally hijacking the past and co-opting history again, for no reason other than it's easier than war. And the Doctor Who hadn't done 1984 before. Their aesthetic, ancient decrepit priests whose best approximation of humanity is the rotting dead, lines up with the image of the pyramid in the title, which is historical and vast but only actually appeared yesterday. It's the claim that should be familiar now, of a traditional foundation for a new leadership in an old world that never really existed. A golden era that's actually entirely simulated. And it also tugs on the colonialist folk myth that the pyramids were built by aliens, which both in the story and in real life suggests that a people are so inferior and in need of ruling that they must have had help to build anything impressive. This itself echoes an earlier rulesy monster, the Silence, who insinuate that every little green man sighting is a corrupt memory of Earth's secret rulers, which changes the political dynamics of a story entirely. And adding to this air of abstract aristocracy, it seems worth noting that the voice of the monks is performed by one Timothy Charles Robert Noel Bentinck, the 12th Earl of Portland, Count Bentinck, and Waldeck Limpberg. Although, on the other hand, Britain is just sort of like this. Jean Baudrillard famously accused The Matrix of being the kind of film about The Matrix that The Matrix would have been able to produce. Meaning that by turning this idea of derealization into a Hollywood blockbuster, it becomes, itself, a derealizing force. Like Bostrom's paper before, the film sets up a false binary, that there's real and unreal, and if we're not in the Matrix, which we can't be if we're watching the film, then we must belong to the real world. And Baudrillard's correct. However much the Matrix is about resisting the system, and it is a product and a tool of that system too. It couldn't exist if it wasn't. It wouldn't have been made. The last Matrix movie was yanked into existence and turned against itself and what it means in the perfect embodiment of this criticism.
Warner Brothers has decided to make a sequel to the trilogy.
What?
They informed me they're going to do it with or without us.
The same's true of Extremis, and of the simulation inside Extremis, the Doctor's defeat of which does nothing in the long run to actually avert the monk's grander plan. Mark Fisher describes a world program so vast and so plastic as to contain its own opposition, which describes the Veritas and the monk simulation perfectly. The prelude to the monk trilogy is an episode called Oxygen. This is a perfect example, because this is the most explicitly anti-capitalist story the show's produced in decades, possibly ever. And yet, merchandise is sold of the soullessly reanimated puppet people who are the story's monsters. It's an episode depicting the successful revolution and the overthrowing of capitalism, but then it ends. And it ends on a cliffhanger, so you have to tune in next week and keep paying your license fee. Or HBO Max, if you're watching there, guides you algorithmically to their new Game of Thrones spin-off. Obviously, this section was recorded before the Disney deal went public, but talk about predicting the future. The Doctor himself is president of the world for the runtime of The Pyramid at the End of the World, and like all the times he's been president of the world before, it's just a gag. This system, the program we're all stuck in, is so much bigger than us that the most powerful man in the world doesn't stand a chance. The revelation of the Veritas that drives all who read it to suicide isn't just that we're not real, but that the very act of living in this system enforces it. and that we are being used as weapons in a war against the hypothetical freer world that might exist outside ours. Even this video is a cog in the machine learning advertising patterns on YouTube, just talking about this feeling that I'm describing is dangerous. I'm feeding the beast right now. So what do we do? Well, in Extremis, we're left with no choice. There's an awful irony in how this realization leads to derealization. That derealization sends some, most of us, I would guess, retreating into fantasies and stories and video games and internet rabbit holes. Any form of escapism, which, I mean, if you've not thought about it before, is a quietly terrifying word to use on a regular basis. So we find a simulation. A passion, some hobby that doesn't matter so much, and we immerse ourselves in that small world entirely until we don't even remember what was outside the cave. We just sit, consuming the shadow play on the opposite wall. The light entertainment. The cutaway side plot in Extremis is odd for Doctor Who, because it doesn't relate back to the main plot in the way you would expect it to. But it is doing a few things. The use of flashbacks assert that the simulated unreal characters have all the same memories and experiences as the real ones, if there's such a distinction even to be made. The reveal of who's in the vault, surprising nobody, is the first beat of Missy's rehabilitation, and the paper-thin plot of this section of the story is a sort of dialectic between contrasting moral values, but not between the characters that you might expect. To synoptify? To summarise, the Master, the universe's baddest bad guy, is being killed for her countless crimes by the Doctor on behalf of these Douglas Adams-esque bureau-punk bookkeepers who've systematised and ritualised all the universe's executions. Down to their wrist devices, these guys parallel the crew of the Tesselector from an earlier story by the same writer dealing with the same issue. These are people who believe that because someone is a bad person, bad things should happen to them. And, maybe more directly, they're equated to the men of the Vatican. All three are defeated, in the end, by the higher power that they follow. They're servants to a light from above, which brings us back to the cave. They accept the wisdom of the hierarchy and uphold it by keeping others in the dark. And what more perfect embodiment of a righteous authority from above than monks? Importantly, the Doctor's only here by some vague legal quirk that's implicated him and co-opted him into being a cog in this killing machine. He doesn't want to be part of the system. He just is, by the way that that system works. The misdirect that the episode plays between the Doctor and Missy, where it's not immediately clear which of them is doing the killing and which is doing the being killed, highlights the interchangeability of the two of them. The fact that either one could be at the throwing end of the killing switch or the killing end. And the Doctor affirms this at the end of the episode when he brings up his own list of crimes.
You do seem to have an impressive record.
This debate, then, isn't between the two of them, as pillars of good and evil, as lots of people want to paint them, but instead between them as imperfect individuals standing together and a system. But Missy is evil. So doesn't she deserve punishment? Missy's morality, or immorality, is framed with the exact same kind of disassociation that we're talking about here. She's not just arbitrarily a really big fan of murder.
Why does one pop a balloon? Because you're pretty.
She likes people the way that most people like pigs. This kind of moral relativism, descended fully into nihilism, is really all I think cruelty actually is. Just look at the appropriation of the term red pill by far-right groups, where seeing through the matrix has come to mean buying out of ethics altogether. And of course it has. If you believe in any sense that the people in your world are just shadows or NPCs, then there's nothing not worth doing to them for even the smallest advantage or pleasure. This collision of poles, Baudrillard writes in Simulation and Simulacra, destroys the possibility of morality entirely. Again, this is all in the text itself. There's countless contradictory accounts of what made the master mad, but seeing as we're talking about screens today, why don't we look at the only televised account? As a child, the master was taken to a tear in the fabric of space-time, to stare out of reality itself, which the doctor says causes some to lose their minds and others run away. There's a third option too, but we'll come around to that. These Antipode characters were both taken to a hole in the fourth wall, where they saw the opening titles of the TV show that they're a part of. Explicitly, then, it was their reactions to this moment of derealization that set both lead hero and lead villain of the show on their respective paths. Both characters know and have always known that they're fictional. What's breaking the fourth wall but madness with an audience? Both characters, before Extremis and outside the simulation, have seen the Veritas truth behind the world, in a heightened version of the feeling that I feel quite a lot of the time. Everything about them is pre-written, not because they're fictional, but for the same reason it is for all of us. We're just a product of our experiences. That's a matter of cold and hard fact. Like the computer struggling to generate a random number, every output, every action we're capable of producing is just inputs run through the pre-programmed algorithms that are our brain. And any changes to the algorithms of our brain are themselves the product of those algorithms and inputs that we don't control. Experience and environment is all we are. This is the fear the Veritas feeds. It's what the shorthand earlier was gesturing towards. It literally doesn't matter if Bostrom's proof works or not, and it doesn't really, because it's not black and white. It's not binary. It doesn't matter if we're in a simulation, or if we're fictional characters, or if we're just flesh robots, like everyone's predicted. Our lives aren't our own. That's what scares particle physicists and priests, and it scares me too. But that fear doesn't have to make you cruel or cowardly. Doesn't have to make you run away or try to escape. But it does have to make you mad. That's it, I'm afraid. The script runs out there. I hope you didn't find the meta stuff too frustrating, and if you did, well, don't worry, it's over now. The video ended with a call to arms. The man in the cave realizes that what he has to do now is transmute his despair into a righteous anger and a determination to fight. But fight how? This is where people get stuck. The political derealization that we've been talking about, like all those characters in their various simulations, is all about a system of control that exists out of reach. To make explicit what I hope I've already communicated, the simulation isn't real. It's a rhetorical tool. Even if you buy one of the proofs, and I know that sometimes I do, they apply just as much to the apparently real world above as they do the apparently simulated world of the person concocting the proof. The question, then, isn't whether you exist, but how much power you have over your existence. The simulation doesn't need to be literally real for it to be true that your life is, in some way, simulated. That other people write the rules. That those casting shadows at the mouth of the cave above you control your view of the world. but if the proof shows that those men, too, are more likely to be acting on the instructions of something even further above, it also holds that the man in the cave, however unreal he might feel, can cast shadows as well. And while it is true that those higher up in this hierarchy have more to benefit from this arrangement, all of us, every single one, is part of the same cave system. In their paper on synergistic storytelling, Agamanolis, Davenport, Barry and Bradley and Brooks talk about the fifth wall as that which divides us from one another. In the same way that the Matrix is constricted by the cinema system and Oxygen was constricted by the television system, video essays like this one on YouTube are constricted by the medium of their platform. In academia and publishing and art too, the products of the system are never going to be able to break down the system. I'm on the wrong side of the screen. There's nothing I can actually do from in here. For all my metaphorical tearing down of fourth wall hierarchies so far, I have not actually damaged a single existing structure. It's been useless. Waste of half an hour. But I made it anyway. Does have to make you mad. As this three-episode epic comes to an end, and the battle of ideologies and over history comes to a head, the Doctor sets out to replace the monk's fake version of history with his apparently true version. But when he jokes earlier in the episode about making some fixes to the human psyche, it becomes clear that any objective true history is unobtainable if it even exists.
Well, I could even throw in some other stuff. You know, things that I could change just by thinking.
And if it was obtainable, it wouldn't be enough to win. But when Bill plugs herself into the machine, she changes the conversation. She stops arguing over what's the true story and focuses instead on the story. A bit of kindness passed forwards, a modicum of idealism, a coping mechanism in the face of a terrible world, and that's what leads the revolution, throws the monsters out. It's what grounds her. What saves the world is the thing that makes her feel real. So those two meanings in the title are one meaning. Tidier. The lie of the land is a lie about the lie of the land. It's misinformation about the playing field. It's the fake news that there's more of them than there are of us. The episode says that this is the ultimate point of propaganda, to outnumber the many with the few. And it's what Bill rejects when she makes her own story known. She doesn't prove that she's real, but that she matters. And she does it the only way that anybody ever can. By sharing something personal, and hoping to hope that it makes a difference. Because if the systems above us, like Plato's cave, conspire to keep you and I separated, in the dark to one another, let's make ourselves known instead, in exactly the same way that Bill does. You don't know how to fight? Make something up. Back in Extremis itself, the simulation is wrapping up as the episode reaches its runtime. The story's over, and all the characters are being unwritten. Standing in the hollow shell of the most powerful room in the world, with the hollow shell of the most powerful man, there's nothing that any individual with any amount of influence can actually do. And then from his jacket pocket, the Doctor takes his late wife's bright blue diary. It's an artifact from so long ago that it actually belongs to a different era of this TV show, but like the flashbacks that we saw before, that distance only further affirms that it's memories, the stories of our lives, that make us. As the colour of the thing implies, River's diary, in being the story of her life, is a description of the Doctor, in the same way that all our lives are inevitably descriptions of the people closest to us, who we allow to see us. And it gives us the mantra, like a manifesto.
Without hope, without witness, without reward.
So death reaching its hand towards him. The Doctor emails the Doctor. He records the events of the episodes and he titles them Extremis. It's a warning that there's a power above that needs deposing, instruction on how to do it. He gives his life, in the end, literally, to send a message. Here's the last magic trick of the episode. The Doctor says that every jumped up little subroutine can email, but in computing terms, that's not true. It's a bad metaphor. You might even call it a plot hole if you're really inclined to, but it is true of the thing that it's a metaphor for. We can all email, however subordinary or routine our lives are. The allegory falls through, and the episode addresses the audience directly. We can all make some noise. The only thing that can perforate upwards through these hierarchical boundaries are ideas. Turning on light in the dark, not so that you can see better, but so that you can be seen by others and on your own terms. So I think that's why I made this, and probably why anyone makes anything like this. Not for the reward of success of any kind, nor for the witness of an audience, no offense, nor even the hope of toppling the system, which I just can't do from in here. But that's not the point. We heard before from the horse's mouth itself about the three possible reactions to realizing the confrontational unreality of the world we live in. Going mad? Running away? We talked about both of them in depth, and they're perfectly valid reactions. But the third choice was to be inspired. So when you make something, however short, however shallow, however cringe, if you make yourself seen by other people who are in the same dark as you, then you're slipping messages through enemy lines. I can't save the day, not by myself, but I can throw the punch that I've got and help the next person in my position to do the same. This is a message for you. So if information is all I am, if making myself seen is the only thing I can really do from this dark side of the screen, let me offer my perspective. The Doctor says that he pities Mario, the man who dies and dies again. But the basic logic of any video game hero is that they get to try again, and every time the player has just a little bit more practice. Every time he fails, a little closer than the time before, he passes on some insight to the next version of himself, who in time will get closer still. So if you really want to pity someone, pity Bowser. Because it might take Mario a million lives, but the simplest rules of the system that Bowser represents say that there's just no way for the dragon to stay on top. Or, in other words, I think there's still a chance we could win this thing.